Comeuppance Network.
This is how to watch TV.
On Comeuppance Network.
Chronologically Lost with Joel and Jenna. My name is Joel.
I'm Jenna, and he's winded also.
I had to walk all the way to the kitchen.
We're brought to you by Comeuppance Network. You can find all of our social media links at thisishowtowatchtv.com. Don't forget to click on that Amazon link when you're doing all of your holiday shopping on the website.
Yes, and hit me up on the Twitter if you have anything you want to talk about, or just comment under this video or whatever. Subscribe on iTunes as well. There's the audio version. With all that crap out of the way, what else was I going to say? Oh, I started posting the Chronologically Lost, like, write-ups. Basically just my notes going through each of the episodes. It pretty much just kind of combs through them, so you can consider it a recap. Those are going to start appearing on thisishowtowatchtv.com. There'll just be a little recap thing, and you can pick the show.
Nice.
I'll post them for all the shows that we talk about, because why the hell not?
I feel like you should charge people for that, because you spend, like, hours doing those write-ups.
I spend the amount of time of the episode plus about 20 minutes, because I'll pause it every once in a while. Really, I'm like, okay, so this thing, what the fuck are they talking about here?
Yeah, it makes
episodes take forever. And it makes it like homework, so it's totally fine. Right.
For the people that are watching the podcast, you can enjoy Joel's new glasses that he got today. They're so cute. He looks so smart and sophisticated.
I have a headache, so that's been fun.
Apparently they're too tight.
I think they're too tight, yeah. The vision seems to be all right.
Okay.
My old glasses looked kind of like that
that's
guy's.
That's true.
So we're in 1990. We're in the 12th episode.
Yep.
I can't believe
that I've sat with you here for 12 weeks already.
Right, in a row.
That's crazy.
Every single week.
That's a record for our life, spending that much time together.
Valid. 1996 to 1999. Had a nice chunk of time here. Notice what we did not see from this episode.
Any Dharmaville?
No, we did not see the Desmond and the Ladder thing with Penny. Remember, we were trying to fit in where it was?
Oh, yeah, I forgot.
We did not see that scene here. So,
maybe they forgot to put it in?
Can the Lost Encyclopedia be wrong? Is that possible? I mean, the foreword is by Lindelof and Carlton Cuse. It's not like they verified every fact in it.
What does the foreword mean? That they just...
They wrote at the beginning of the book.
Oh, well,
so that doesn't mean necessarily that every fact inside it is accurate.
You
that might
think
be their
that they would have double-checked it, but maybe they didn't care.
I'm interested to see where that scene does pop up, because there's no way it can't. It has to appear at some point. It's possible
that they, like, forgot to put it in.
I bet you they went through meticulous notes. The people that did this really had their shit together, because I don't know how they even managed to end them on... like, relatively important moments, too. They seem to get the timing
The openings, the opening credits and the ending Lost is always good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, oh, that wrapped it up pretty well.
Yeah,
they don't leave too many cliffhangers, you know.
There's not a whole lot, because we wrap up a whole year.
Yeah.
It's not a whole lot of them are over multi-year storylines, but the Michael one is, anyway. So we get Michael talking to a lawyer about what happened to his leg. And he's trying to get custody from Walt's mother, Susan, and he's like, I'm going to take real good care of you, Mr. Dillon. He's like, it's Dawson. Like,
right.
So that's just indicative of the kind of treatment this guy's willing to, or capable of
providing.
Giving, Susan wants Michael to sign away Walt so Brian can adopt him, but it would give up all his paternal rights. And he's like, there's not a whole lot we can do. We could file an injunction.
Right.
He's like, that. Yeah.
He's just
clinging at this point.
But here's the thing. For me, this was out of order, because she already told him at the end of the last episode that she wanted to take all the paternity rights or whatever from Michael and give it to it so that her boyfriend could adopt
Walt. But Michael didn't, like, agree to it.
No, but he acted like it was the first time that he heard about it. Like, what? She wants all my rights? Like, no.
Well, no. The lawyer was telling him the legality of what she wanted. the legality of it. What he said is that it will be no different than any other kid when you see him walking down the street. That was the part where he was like, oh, wow. You know, like, that's the implication of what that means.
Take it like that. It, no? To me, it was that he was acting like it was the first time that he had ever heard it. And...
But he went to this guy. So it's guy's telling him. So, yeah, he's just, maybe he's just wrapped up in the moment trying to defend his logic to want to do this.
Yeah.
The guy says he's going to need a shitload of money to proceed. It's David versus Goliath. And is he sure? And he's like, they're not taking my son away. And then they have one of those arbitration meetings.
Mm-hmm.
The way that... You could ask this question. When was the last time you saw your son? Right. Reasonable question, right? When was the last time you actually saw your son?
Right.
So much shittier.
So shitty.
That lady was trying to provoke him.
Right, but... None of that was his fault.
Yeah.
Completely the
and
mom's
he said,
fault.
But he then said about a year, and she goes, actually, it's 14 months. I'm no mathematician here, but 14 months is about a year.
Right. A little over.
I mean,
but
that's about a year.
Yeah.
In the most general terms.
About, yes.
Yeah. That's literally what I said, bitch. I said about a fucking year, and it's 14 months.
I mean, she's a good lawyer, and that's what they're trying to prove, that she's going to win, you know, but she was being mean.
Yeah. She's trying to figure out why. He's like, well, why didn't you have a problem with her taking him to Amsterdam, but now you do to Rome? Like, that seems inconsistent. You know, and then she brings up the accident.
He was going to come. That's not, like,
He wasn't going to go. Well, yes. You mean the fact that she said no.
No, she said.
Oh, I got you.
She said, you can't come with me to Amsterdam. And he let her go. She started up shop. He called. He was checking in on Walt. And then he heard her with the boyfriend, and he said, I'm coming. He got hit by a car.
Yes,
so none of that was his fault.
That delayed him a year
and a
half.
Okay, so it delayed him a year and a half. She just so happened to pay for his recovery because she is conniving and wanted
to make
it work.
Well, she feels bad. And it also, at this point, then she looks good for the courts.
Which is fine. But he wanted to be part of Walt's life. She said no.
No, I don't disagree with you at all there. Michael's pissed at this point. And then she's like, what were Walt's first words? What's his favorite food? What a bitch.
I mean, that's so hurtful.
For someone who wants to retain their paternal rights, you don't know much about your son. Like, again,
she's playing every
to what
card
you're
she
saying,
can.
That's not...
None of that was his fault.
Yeah, he wanted to be with his son. She just, like, said, basically, you're poor. You can't provide. I'm out.
I think it was more that she had her goals.
No, now she's saying that. She said she was like telling him, like,
oh,
you're basically,
you're getting evicted.
What are you
going to
do?
Blah,
yeah. So this is when they talk without the lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
And she thinks he's going to win.
Mm-hmm. Which he would have.
Why did I put the boat?
Is there a boat on the wall?
She thinks he's going to win. Oh, yeah, there's a boat behind her that kind of looked like the one that Charles Widmore had in his office and that Richard Alpert was making in the bottle kind of thing. Just, you know, one of those.
I mean,
those through lines.
She's good.
That we keep
so is she
across.
A lawyer? I don't even remember. What was she doing in Amsterdam with? She said something about a firm, so I thought that she was going to Rome and
she
gonna
was
going to be a partner.
She was going to law school or something like that. Yeah,
well, but I thought he put her through law school. So,
damn, I hope it was law school.
I thought so, that he worked at construction.
He was doing construction, then got laid off.
So she could go through law school, and then she got a job with this guy, and she wanted to take the opportunity to go to Amsterdam and work with him, and then she
ended up falling for him, or had already fallen
for
him.
She probably already did and wanted to go there. And
so
now,
that they could be
together.
And she
said, we're going to go to Rome, and I could be a senior partner there, which makes sense.
And he's taking over the thing there. And,
right.
Yeah. So, so she thinks he's going to win and keep her from leaving the country. And then she asks why, which is the same thing that we've been... That's another recurring thing. Locke and Ben both ask that a lot.
Why,
He's his father, and he needs... she says he needs to get his shit together so that he can get back to his art. So she says, how are you going to do any of that and still be part of Walt's life? Like, Jesus.
Right.
How could he possibly get a job and draw and be a dad? I mean, I don't know.
I mean, I don't understand why there was never the opportunity for him to move to Rome with them.
I mean, just
and not live with them.
Yeah, just
he could live in Rome, get a job, and draw pictures while being in his son's life.
Or if she's willing to pay for his recovery, why not just pay for an apartment for a year and fund his art the way he took care of you when you went to school?
Right. Bitch.
God.
Oh, she made me so mad. But, I mean, like, I honestly tried to see her side of this. Yeah. I really did. Nothing other than selfish comes to mind. I mean, she wanted to have this perfect family with two rich parents who have great jobs and...
Well, she keeps playing it it's about the kid.
Yeah.
And that's so bullshit.
None of that was about Walt. It was 100% about her, and she's a selfish bitch. That's all it is. And Michael got conned into giving up his son. Yeah. That's the bottom line.
He says Walt is his responsibility too, and she's like, then let him go.
Right. Totally selfish.
She asked him to sign, let him go. Like, just, again, another let go kind of thing. Yeah. But this is one where he shouldn't have let go.
He should not have let go.
So then we cut to Walt not letting go of his mom's hand.
Yeah.
And Michael on the park bench waiting for Susan and Walt. And Michael tries to introduce himself, but instead just gives Walt a polar bear, which that obviously plays in later.
Yeah.
The one that Walt manifested, I think, is what we come to the realization of, that Walt manifested the big, huge polar bear.
Because his dad drew it for him all the time?
Because it was in that comic book.
In the comic book. But, so he doesn't get the letters and stuff until later, right?
Correct.
When he's on the island?
Before.
Just before.
Yeah, before they go, when he gets him. Because he gets him, he goes to Australia to get Walt before he gets on 8:15.
Okay.
So, like, they don't even really know each other.
Right, okay.
It's like, you're coming with me kind of thing, and then he gives him the notes.
Because
eventually.
The dad didn't want him. Brian Porter never wanted to be Walt's father.
No, he just wanted to nail Susan. So, after he gives him the polar bear, he explains that they're not going to see each other for a while, but he is going to have a great life, and that was just so fucking sad.
It was terrible.
Michael endorses Brian, in a way. He kind of, he's like, to Walt.
Yeah.
No matter where he goes, your daddy loves you very much, and Walt doesn't react. And Michael asks her to let him know it's from him, and they say goodbye. And then we go to the opening credits.
Yep.
I mean, that storyline is...
I'm glad it's over, because I'm ready for her to die, and Walt...
Oh, that's right,
back
she does die.
Yeah, Walt to go back with her dad, with his dad. She's just so terrible. Like... Yeah, so then who raised Walt?
Michael's mom.
Oh, did they say that?
Yeah, his grandma. Walt's grandma raised him.
Oh, I didn't know that. So he got off the island and went home, and Walt's grandma...
And then Michael tried to kill himself.
Okay, but never in any of this, the grandma wasn't involved when...
In any what?
I mean...
The custody battle that's non-existent because they were never married? He's just the baby daddy, in essence. That's the woman's right.
Well, that's
kind
why
of thing.
She gave him her last name.
Yeah.
When he was born.
Because she knew her plan.
Yeah.
That she wasn't going to stay with him.
Right. I guess. I mean.
But that's the whole thing. They never got married, so she has 100% rights to the baby.
But
they both
feel
made.
Like grandparents still have some rights.
But she
probably not a lot, but some. And I feel like if. They just kind of made up Michael's grandma to fit that after everybody was gone.
No, Michael's mom, because it was the only person he could rely on. So he gave his son to her to take care of, and then he went off to try to kill himself.
They got off the island together?
Yeah, Michael and Walt left. They left on the boat, remember?
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay, anyway, we're in 1996 still.
Sorry.
Maybe 97. I don't know at this point exactly.
I do not remember any of this scene. None.
You don't remember this
storyline
at all?
Not a. I'm like, who's this guy? And
who's
what?
Jesse Pinkman Jr. here?
Is that him?
No,
that's not him.
It just looks
They do look similar, but I don't.
This is Eddie.
Yeah.
Eddie's a cop. Spoiler alert.
Right, and I did not know that.
He's looking for work, or what? This is, all the stuff is just what he says. He's looking for work and says he had to get out of where he came from. He's playing Deluxe, his mom's dead, dad's a drunk, the rain clears and they get pulled over. And he's like, what, did you rob a bank? Yep, sorry, afraid so.
Yeah.
cop says taillights out, but that was really just the cop checking to make sure that he got in the car.
Oh, yeah. Which makes sense.
Yeah, to check and make sure that they're in together. And he saw when, after he showed him the guns and groceries, which was a great line about what's in the back.
Right.
Paperwork's all in order, and he's like, I could take you in for picking up a hitchhiker. And then the kid, Eddie, goes, no, it's my uncle. I asked him to come pick me up. And then Locke, like, goes along with it.
Yeah.
Proving that he is, you know, amenable to coercion.
Yes.
So he's getting conned again. And then Eddie asks, what's up with all the guns, uncle?
Right.
And we cut to a place where Locke seems to be quite happy.
He was so happy.
It's like a commune there. Doesn't it feel like sort of hippie-ish, like Dharma-ish in a way?
Yeah.
Like Mike particularly looks like somebody who could have been in Dharma.
Definitely did. I thought the same thing when I saw him. Like, was he in Dharmaville?
Yeah,
was
no, he hanging he's out with... sort of Horace, a mix yeah, of Horace and like with... Goodwin and yeah. some of those people.
He was cool in it.
How did he get over Helen so quickly? Locke in this.
Was it only a year or the same year?
I mean, this is 96. The last one was 95 to 96.
Well, I mean, if she left him, then maybe he just found the commune right after that and started living there. And
yeah, I mean, he's desperate for any sort of family. Because he said at one point,
you know, I'm thankful for being here during, like, his dinner grace. Yeah,
where he said I was able to get...
He said, thank you for helping me get over my anger or something.
Yeah. Yeah, and finding a real family.
Right.
Okay, so this is where the sweat lodge originated.
Mm-hmm.
That little tent thing. I took a screenshot before I let that part play, and then they go and explain it. I'm like, could this be where the sweat lodge on the island? And then, yeah, it just outright says.
So you did a Jenna ask a question and they answer it?
I wrote down what I thought was a clever question, insightful thing.
Right,
no. Eddie's wearing a Geronimo Jackson t-shirt.
I don't know who that is.
That's one of the bands from the show. Like, it was a band that they made up an album. Oh, it was Dharma Lady song.
I remember them making a comment about it, but I was like, oh, that must be a band that I don't know because I was, like, too young at that point in time.
No, they made it up for the show. It was in Locke's locker at school.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they've been throwing it in there. Well, he says about the sweat lodge, you go in there and figure out if you're a farmer or a hunter. And he's like, which one are you, John?
Right.
And, of course, he doesn't answer. John introduces Eddie to Mike and Jan at dinner, and they say John is a very special guy. Or Mike says that.
Yeah.
You know, it's just another reinforcement of telling him he's special and treating him like they love him until
they...
I don't know. It wasn't like that, though, this time. He did fuck up.
He did.
He absolutely fucked up.
He didn't mean to, and he'd like... I mean, Eddie did a great job of pretending that he was like this lost soul that needed a family, and he's like, thank you.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
and
exactly.
I really
that
like bought into it. I was so shocked when he was a cop.
Really? You didn't see
like,
it coming?
Oh my God.
So, yeah, that ends that. And then we cut over to Charlie playing Wonderwall on the streets of London.
Right.
It starts raining, and then. Nadia sure gets around, huh?
She definitely does. What is she doing?
What is she just doing in London?
Country hopping.
Because she was in Iraq, and then she was in California or wherever Locke lived.
She got a house there.
And then now she's
maybe she's
just,
on vacation?
I guess. She's just
bombing,
wandering the
bombing police people and
I don't know
alleyways.
I don't know if she's bombing. Yeah, maybe. I guess she could be bombing.
I don't know. I mean, it's nice to see her in this sense as far as now she's supposed to be somewhat normal. You know, I mean, she's not supposed to be a terrorist at this point, I don't think. You know, it seemed like she bought that house in California.
Yeah, I'm not sure
how
that all...
doing there.
I'm not sure what her thing is. Again, I don't know if this is one of those things where they're guessing on a time frame or if they weren't... obviously... the writers of Lost weren't thinking about it in this order.
No.
So this may just be one of those casualties to where it just kind of doesn't really make a whole lot of sense, but...
Or they just wanted Nadia to have...
They wanted to have a tie-in with Charlie.
Talk to everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Charlie stops the guy trying to rob her and gives her purse back. And he was, like, all laughing about it and all, like, you know, as you are, all adrenaline rush afterwards. And he's like, whew, last fight I had was when I was 8. I got my ass kicked.
Right.
And then she calls him a hero. And then he says he just did what anyone would do. And when she said three people walked by, and like the way he like turned around, like, what, really?
Right.
Like, that made me tear up. I don't know why. It was just so...
It was good. She did a good job at that point. I liked her...
Just showing what a good guy he is, too,
and
there.
It was raining, and she's like, you know, but you could tell she was still emotional, even though you can't really see tears in her face.
Yeah. But, I mean, and then showing that Charlie was just a good guy still, you know, through all this stuff, the band stuff coming up.
Right.
But, yeah, just reinforcing that he thinks naively, well, that's what anybody would do. And she's like, no, literally three people just did not
do that.
So, let's see. John and Eddie are friendly. And then Eddie tries to set up John and Lizzie because she wants a daddy like everyone else here. You should take advantage of that. And Locke did not find that funny at all.
No. But so at this point,
offended.
He knew what Locke's dad had done to him. If he already did his background check on Locke, Eddie knew everything. So he was just playing
Locke. That's why he was saying that like his mom was dead and dad was a drunk, trying to play into that. I needed to get away from where I was.
Right.
The same kind of shit Locke said at dinner. He was like, I just needed to get away from my old family. Those guys sucked.
Yeah.
So then he asks about John's dad, and then he's like, there's just nothing worth talking about.
Right.
Nothing good. What's in the greenhouse? What's the big secret?
Right.
I've been here for like 6 weeks.
Yeah. He's like, I went in on the bomb.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Mike and Jan talk about family, but they have a lot of secrets. And I see what's going on with the fertilizer, and I want in. And he's like, you want in on what? He's like, you guys are going to blow something up, and I want in. And Locke is doing that thing that he does where he eats fruit.
Right.
And laughs.
Creepy. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know. So do you think he knew they were growing weed, or they didn't know what they were doing in there?
Good question. It's the mid-90s. I would guess mid to late 90s. I would guess that they would be doing this for a weed raid.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't like it is now where anybody can, you know, where it's so much easier to grow and stuff than it would be, you know, 20
years ago.
Apparently
all you need is fertilizer, so. But I mean, well, we should get on top of that and make some money and just have a big farm and everybody eats in a picnic setting outside.
Just fertilizer. That's all we need.
Okay.
Locke goes to the greenhouse, and he's looking for Jan and Mike, and the guy kind of snarkily says, well, they're looking for you, too.
Yeah.
He's like, well, then it's good timing.
Right, perfect, then I'm here.
Okay, weirdo.
Right.
He goes in, and they're all trying to bail out. Basically, they figured out Eddie's a cop, and he played John, and John got burned again, and he's like, it's not too late to fix this.
Right, poor John. He really wanted to stay there. He was happy.
Yeah,
you know?
He had, and now they're leaving him, but this time he knows it's his fault, I think.
Right.
You know, whereas before, he was innocent in the thing with his dad.
He was not innocent in the thing with Helen. He could have.
No, with his dad. I mean,
I know.
But yeah, Helen.
Yeah, I mean, he got played and lost his kidney. I mean,
yeah.
Not. I mean, sucks for you. I don't know what else to say about that. But like with Helen, don't lie to your spouse and you're set. I mean, it's pretty freaking easy.
Yeah.
You don't cheat, don't lie. You're set.
Yeah.
You'll have a good life. But
and if you cheat, don't lie about it. John takes Eddie out into the woods hunting. You know, after the whole, is he a hunter or is he a farmer thing?
Yeah, but they... So where
Locke's
are they hunting,
trying to
though?
Prove that he's a
so
hunter.
They're just they live in this, like, wilderness that they can hunt and grow fruit all in the same area?
I guess. What do you mean? Fruit wouldn't attract animals?
Normally, farmland doesn't attract a lot of deer, does it?
I don't know.
Maybe
it was farmland, though. They had the greenhouse for the weed.
I know the greenhouse, but they are eating stuff, so are they only growing fruit trees?
I wouldn't imagine so. I don't know. There's an orchard there.
I need
there,
some details.
You need some
need
details
on
where, what woods did they go
where
to?
Where did they go hunting?
Where are they at geographically in this episode? We need to know. Eddie's still pushing about the greenhouse, and John's like, I set up a meeting after dinner, you know, and Eddie's like, cool.
Yeah.
He's being terrible at it. Bad
douche.
Poker face.
Yeah.
And he points over there, and then Eddie turns around, whoa, and then turns around, and John's pointing at him, and he asks if he knew it would be John. Like, or he asks, did you know it would be me? Or did they know? Did they choose me? And Eddie looks at his gun, but John tells him he didn't load it. Like Russo with the taking the firing pin out. Yes, they chose him. And then he, of course, again asked, why?
I know. So, I mean, all of these flashbacks are always John either being special or being chosen because he so badly wants to be the chosen one from Jacob. And
yeah,
then he just dies. So, you know, no big deal. You're chosen for nothing, John.
Well, that was a self-fulfilling thing. That wasn't from Jacob. That was from Richard Alpert. Because he went to Richard Alpert in the 50s.
John thought he was chosen, and he told Richard Alpert
that he was that before he was even born.
Yeah.
So thereby, Richard Alpert always came to him, and when he was a kid,
and he's like, "There's nothing special about this guy. I don't know why."
And but kept trying to figure out if he was special.
Yeah.
And, yeah. And his mom telling him he's special, and yeah. So let's see. They chose him because he hadn't been there for long. He had no record, and the psyche Val said he'd be amenable for coercion. He's like, it's not personal. And he's like, how is that not personal?
Right, it's very personal.
Yeah, it's pretty personal. And then Eddie just backs up, and he's like, you're a farmer, John. And Locke tries to convince himself that he's a hunter, and Eddie leaves. He's just like, I'm going to go. And then John could have shot him, but doesn't, like he did with the others in the 50s.
Right.
Remember when Sawyer then grabs the gun and tries to shoot at him? Yeah, that's pretty much, I think that's the Locke story for this episode,
I think
right?
So.
I think then we move over to Miles looking like Rufio from Hook.
Yes, just like him.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. He asked to see his mom, and she's sick and losing her hair. That looked really weird, and it was like, okay, can we stop seeing...
He had like a bald cap with like the hair plugs. Yeah. That was pretty good.
He says he's sorry for not coming by sooner, and he asks why he is this way. Why can I do the things that I do?
Right. And she doesn't tell him.
No, and she won't talk to him about his father. So why do you think he can do the things? Because he was from the island?
I think so. He was exposed to that, the radiation and stuff like that, maybe?
The electromagnetism?
Or electromagnetism, yeah. She was exposed to radiation, apparently.
Well, with the cancer?
Yeah.
Potentially? Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I don't know why he can do that. I mean, I guess it's just, it's got to be an island thing.
Well, I would think so. That, or maybe it had something to do with him being born on the island. I mean...
Okay, question then. Was Miles born on the island?
Yeah. Well, I think so.
I thought Ethan was the last baby that was born on the island.
Ethan was born after Miles. Because Miles was a few months old when...
Okay. Oh, yeah, because we only had a week after Ethan was born.
Right.
Okay, that's right. So he was still before...
But we still don't know if Ethan left the island and came back.
No, he grew up with Ben, remember?
I know, but...
Why would he have... Oh, left
after the thing. All the women and children left before the incident.
I would imagine they just left, and then when they found out it was safe or whatever, they came back.
And so...
Probably after they built the swan hatch to contain whatever happened.
So you think that Miles and his mom tried to get in contact with his dad to go back, and he, like, never responded to them, and that's why she thinks that he didn't want anything to do with them? Or because he was a dick trying to get her to leave, then she was like, screw it, we're never going back.
Potentially either one, honestly. I don't think there's a solid answer on that.
So I forgot. Did he die during the incident?
No. I don't know why they said he's dead. I don't know when he died. Pierre Chang did not die at the incident. That's when he lost his arm, and he did orientation videos after that, because he had to do the orientation video for the swan.
Without his arm.
So maybe he died during the purge.
Oh, so we haven't seen those orientation videos?
We haven't seen it because they haven't watched it in the hatch yet.
Okay.
We saw him filming one when Faraday came to him.
Right.
You know, when they went down there because the guy got the thing through the filling through the brain. He was about to film one, but he hasn't filmed the one where he was missing an arm.
Okay.
So he lived through that. I don't know when he died. It must have been the purge. Does anybody know when Pierre Chang died?
I mean,
is there any fact on that? Yeah, I mean, I guess you could look it up in the encyclopedia. She says he never cared about us or you. And where is he? He's dead.
So she knew he was dead.
Well, she's saying that. I don't know that she knows.
Oh.
He kicked us out when you were just a baby, and like you could just tell he wants to know where his body is, because he wants to read the body. He wants to find out how he died. So you found Pierre Chang there?
Mm.
Do we have any answers on the life and death of Pierre Chang?
I'm trying to see family. Laura Chang, wife, Miles Strom, son. Why does he have a different last name? Again.
That's just kind of a thing.
Also
okay.
known as Dr. Marvin Candle, Dr.
Edgar Hallowax.
Mark Wickman and Edgar Hallowax. Hours before the incident, Chang ordered an immediate evacuation of all women and children and other social personnel, including his wife and baby son Miles.
Nothing about him just... I just assumed he died in the Purge. It seems the most logical thing. Is there not like a last page of Chang there?
Oh.
Like, is that the end of it?
It goes to polar bears.
So that's the end of it, and it doesn't say anything in the last box?
Oh, though? Here. Okay, so Chang fought to prevent the incident. Miles helped pull him free, but his arm was severely crushed in several places. His lower arm could not be saved, and he was fitted with a prosthetic. Chang was killed with the rest of Dharma during the Purge.
Nailed it.
Woo!
Okay, moving on.
Thank goodness there was an answer.
Right? Son's mom is telling her, why don't we think to look at the very end?
I mean, seriously.
Son's mom's telling her what to wear for her date, and makes her wear flats in case he's short. You know, worrying about bruised egos.
Right.
And she's like, you didn't find a husband in college. And she's like, I went there for a degree.
Right.
After 4 years of college, she's silver. Don't you want to find a husband before you're a bronze?
Right. Oh, my God.
And her father says she needs to do it now. Just, Jesus. Before you're a bronze. What does that even mean, you're a silver? You're not as good as you were?
Well, you're gold before you go to college because you're young and... Then you go to college, and then you're a little bit older. I don't know. Maybe they're worried about baby-making years.
I guess. Jin is getting dressed as a friend tells him about Destiny. And then he's like, what's the woman look like? You know, that way, in case I see her, I know what, you know, I know to go talk to her. And he says orange.
Right. So did he mean skin?
I don't know.
Like, she
no
was
idea.
Going to be...
I didn't even notice. Was she wearing orange?
No. Well, he didn't see her when she walked past
him.
That's
right. They have
not
met yet.
I feel like when he does see her...
She might be wearing orange.
She was standing in an orange dress or by an orange tree or orange flowers or something. I feel like there was orange played into that.
Okay.
I don't remember, though, so I guess we'll see that probably in the next episode.
We gotta remember that. Okay, so he can barely take care of himself, let alone a woman. And he's like, let the woman take care of you. And he's like, nah, that's not what a man does. Right. A man needs goals in life. Work hard, get promoted, then I'll be respected. Not like the son of a fisherman. It's a very important job interview.
Right.
So, yeah, he's still got that whole Chinese, or that whole pride, Korean pride thing
right.
where it's, you know, if you're this or that, you know, you're lower status.
Yeah.
But it plays into his whole view of male-female relationships where he's like, nah, the woman doesn't take care of the man.
Right.
And I bet Sun would have been down for a little bit of that. She would have been down to pamper to a degree, I think.
I think she wanted an equal relationship.
Yeah.
She didn't want to be, like, this trophy wife.
Yeah, equal. Let's both die and leave our kid abandoned.
Oh.
So Jin's interviewing at the hotel, and he used to be a busboy but got promoted to waiter, and... He was the exception to the rule of we don't promote from within, which that seems like a weird rule.
Why
would you not promote from within? Like, we only hire waiters or busboys. You can't be a busboy and then become a waiter. But Jin was the exception to that rule, where they let him do it. That's such a weird...
I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't get it. So, and then he goes, what village are you from? And then he said, Name or something.
Yeah.
It reminded me of Namaste a little
bit. Yeah.
And he goes, no wonder, I thought I smelled fish on you.
I know, what a jerk.
Yeah, then he pulls the tag off his tie that he was going to return.
I know, he was like, it was so expensive.
So he gets hired and starts immediately. No raise or time off, and he's like, don't open the door for men like you.
I know, so...
Just how do people hold... How...
We weren't raised in an in a.
How do they hold that, their tongue?
Yeah, I mean,
I don't get it.
There, that it must was be just like how it was.
Swift and harsh punishment yeah. to yeah. where people would not.
Like women obeyed men and did certain things.
Yeah, they did.
I mean, it was just a different. It's a different way of life.
Yeah,
totally.
Speaking of, Charlie at confession. last night he had physical relations with a girl that he didn't even know. Then again with another girl. And then he watched them having relations.
Ridiculous.
With each other.
And he felt bad about it.
And he blames it on the band.
Right.
He's like, the girls are tempting. And he makes the choice then that he has to quit the band.
Right.
So we cut to the lobby of the church or whatever. And Liam is wearing a shirt that says Music Slut.
I saw that.
That's spectacular. And he tells him the drive shaft got signed.
Right.
Which... Of Oops. Course, yeah, right after he decided to quit the band, Liam tries to convince him that Charlie is driveshaft,
right.
apparently at Oxford, because that's clearly
that
where
it was?
That's not where they're supposed to be,
no.
but that's clearly what they used for Oxford later, for Daniel Faraday.
I thought
Faraday's
so.
Thing was like, if you go up those stairs, like that yeah. was Faraday's
Okay. thing. I mean, it looked familiar, but I wasn't sure if it was, like, a famous church in London or something.
No, that's Oxford, and that's I don't think that's in London. I don't think that they filmed a lot of stuff off of the island of Hawaii outside
of, like,
LA. Well,
maybe that's
like,
a church
LA.
In Hawaii.
Yeah, I don't know. There's a great website called Lost Locations. Like, it might be lostvirtualtour.com, something like that.
Yeah.
And you can literally look up episode by episode, scene by scene, and see where... geographically it was filmed and they would just
cool.
like for Desmond and Penny in the last episode they or maybe the one before they converted a street to make it look like London
wow
or to make it look you know British or whatever to put up the different street signs and stuff
mm-hmm. put so a phone booth because none of those exist
yeah,
anymore
right. So interesting note I thought was that they said that Charlie wrote the songs.
Oh,
it's like, we're getting signed off of your songs.
Oh, yeah.
And Liam's like, I just sing. I'm just... he made some self-deprecating remark.
Yeah.
And Charlie says the band isn't who he is. And Liam says Charlie won't get lost in the band because he'll look out for him.
Right.
And that's what brothers do. And he's like, promise me one thing. If things get too crazy, if I say they're done, then we walk away.
Right.
And he's like, that's good, baby brother. You're a bloody rock god.
Ugh.
You know, he's the
I'll
rock god,
I'll look out
god,
for
so.
You, just like when you were drowning in the pool and I didn't do anything about it. I'm just kidding.
So, Sun's matchmaker has found her a guy whose family owns 13 hotels. And...
Why? I mean, I don't know why I didn't do that. I mean, a matchmaker to just
yeah.
find you a rich guy?
Yeah,
perfect.
Why not?
Sounds amazing.
Jin holds the door open for her, but has his head down.
Yeah, he didn't look.
I don't understand the culture. I don't get that. I get the respect side of it, but I don't understand, I guess, the people being so humble. Like, Jin being as humble as he has to
be. Well,
Jin
was okay with the upper levels looking down on him, and that's what I don't get. Because,
yeah.
I mean, if somebody holds a door for me, I'm going to look at them in the eyes and say, thank you.
Yeah.
Like, I understand that that's their job, and that's, you know, whatever, but they're not any worse than me. What? I don't...
But they're not, but the people that are walking in there that he's holding, he wouldn't let you in.
He would not let me in,
because you're
guess.
A person
that's
like
true.
Him.
That's very true.
Let's see. The mothers compliment each other about each other's kids' colleges.
Right.
It's like all this kind of
backhanded...
Well,
that's no Harvard,
They're
but...
complisulting each
yeah.
other. The matchmaker and the mothers excuse themselves, and then... They kind of go back and forth about who's pressuring who the most, and
yeah.
the son, dad via mom, and the guy, mom via dad, via aunt, via grandmother.
Yeah.
Then son studies art, like Michael. I didn't make that connection
yeah.
before, and they both agree that this setup isn't terrible.
Right.
So Desmond is in military jail.
But they never said why.
Did
or
they?
Or why he got... his dishonorable discharge.
I mean, is it possible that he didn't go back after the Penny stuff? Remember when he left to tell Penny to call to get the number to get the phone number for her.
Oh, he left the...
He left the army on 2 days leave, remember?
Uh-huh.
Maybe he didn't go back, so he was a deserter.
Maybe.
Are you trying to... I mean, the time, that whole...
No, I was trying to find out... It's not
in the back and forth.
No, I was trying to figure out Desmond connected with Penny shortly after... Well, Desmond's soulmate took him a long time to get... Sorry.
I mean, it's audio dynamite.
I know.
So they return his pocket watch, the picture of him and Penny, and his book, Charles Dickens, Our Mutual Friend, which the guard asks why he didn't bring it inside, and he says to avoid temptation, like Charlie, but successful.
Right.
And Desmond has read every book Charles Dickens has written except this one, and he wants it to be the last thing he ever reads before he dies. And he's been dishonorably discharged. You had all that time, and you still haven't gotten anywhere near it? Are you just, like, reading stuff? That says Charlie. You're not even on the Desmond page.
This says Desmond Hume. What are you talking about? I don't know. This, it talks about all that, but...
When he left the when he left jail, or when he left the army.
Yeah, it totally skips over all of that. Okay. It's... Nothing about... Well, we'll
just have to not know, because Jenna couldn't find it.
I'm sorry. It says that he was the monk, and then he was in the regiment, and then he was a sailboat race captain. It just does not say anything about...
How he went from the military?
No, nothing. It just says that he connected with Penny after being a monk, and...
Yeah, but that was before the military. Right,
and then Charles Woodmore... offered to give Desmond a lift. They remained together for 2 years while she was Desmond's soulmate. It took him a long time to get past his pride, poor judgment, and fear to come back to terms with it. All the while, she suffered through their long separation and waited for him to come back to her for good. So, like, completely just skips over all of it.
Fine. Thanks, Lost Encyclopedia. Right.
Nothing at all. We have no idea what he did.
Yeah.
Saying that he left... he's been
dishonorably discharged...
That makes sense.
Maybe he didn't... Because who knows what psyche he had at that point? Because he flashed back to present, to 2007.
Yeah, so he just was asleep on the bed for 4 years or something like that?
Yeah, exactly. He just was asleep.
So they just discharged him because he was pathetic?
Yeah. So Woodmore is waiting there when he gets out and offers him a ride. And Desmond notices a box and asks if he bought him a present. I thought that was cute.
Yeah.
Two, actually. One box contains your past, the other the future. And it was every single letter he'd ever written to Penny.
Right.
Which, calm it down, psycho. Jesus.
Right, so...
I don't know how long you were in there, but that was a lot of letters.
Right. And so was Widmore just, like, hanging out by Penny's mailbox every day? Or did he, like, pay off the mailman?
I would suggest that Charles Woodmore is powerful enough that he would have had an in at the jail to where it got intercepted leaving.
Oh, that makes more sense. Like, just hanging out by our mailbox. Look at you
going from society's side. This guy ran the island for a while.
Right, I'm sorry. That makes more sense.
Let's see. Woodmore says it was good for Penny to not get the letters because she thinks he's forsaken her, and it's going to stay that way. She moved on and is getting married.
I don't think she gets married.
The second box is full of money. No contact, no calls, no mail, no post, as he puts it. Just run away. He's like, why would I do that? Because you're a coward. I mean, pretty harsh words, but then he does.
He goes, He feels like that's what his destiny is, apparently. But at this point, does he remember that he's not going to call her? For 8 years, or only his future self remembered that?
That's a good question. Well, I would say this.
I don't think this self knows.
Doesn't know the number. This self does not know the phone number.
Oh, so the whole thing was about getting the phone number.
For the present day. Right. For that day on the boat.
So as soon as he flashed back, he had no idea. He called
her.
No, I'm saying, like... As soon as the future self went out of his present... As soon as his future
consciousness left, as Faraday was saying about Eloise, the mouse. Yeah, so his present consciousness left the 90s and went back to present. And with that, he took the information.
Right, so he doesn't know.
So this Desmond doesn't even remember that, going and meeting up with Penny.
Right, okay.
Which is weird.
I mean, He'll remember it in the future.
Remember it at the time of the call, which is all that matters, because,
So you're going to flash back and paint the living room, too?
Yeah. That's my first disappointment in this thing. I love this chronologically,
but... We only caught it because of the back and forth diagram.
And we don't know
here.
That that's valid, necessarily.
Right.
Okay, so Sun's at a fancy restaurant, and then Jin on the door. He opens the door for Sun's date, and the guy asks to borrow Jin's flower. Mr. Lee is the guy's name, and he tells her of the time he got stuck in the hallway with only a towel, and he wants to keep seeing her, and he's like, we wouldn't have any matchmakers, any blah blah, we can be free. And that felt like kind of what her idea was, to get away from her dad,
right?
To be free. And he wants to tell her a secret, and she's all in at this point. And
no.
He tells her that he met a woman at Harvard, and in 6 months he's going to move there and marry her. And Sun totally did not see that coming.
Did not. And she was totally brokenhearted.
Yeah, and she, like, bailed out of embarrassment slash broken heart. Her storyline is kind of shitty, too.
It sucks.
So, we get Sawyer, and he's laying with Jessica. I only know that. That's the first name I've looked up, because I thought she was the...
The baby mama?
I thought she was her at the very beginning. Then I thought, oh, it's Megan from The League.
The wife of
Pete.
Oh.
That he divorced right away after the first episode.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not her either.
Okay.
So, I found out her name's Jessica, and it's like Kristen Richardson or something. I don't know. I don't know her from anything else.
I think I've seen her in other stuff.
Sawyer's pulling a con here. He says he loves her. Aww. And what does she want? And she's like, how could I want anything else? I got this of man meat laying right in front. Are you just going to turn pages?
I am.
It's audio dynamite. He pulls the I'm late for a meeting thing, or she's like, aren't you late? No, it's at 3:30. It's 3:28. Drops the shitload of cash from the briefcase.
I mean, who's still in bed at 3:28? What? I mean, I understand that they were
bed.
Maybe
they stayed up late because they got all kinds of money.
They're definitely in their 30s. Like, what are you doing in the middle of the day
at 3 p.m.
in a motel room? You're trash. That's all.
I thought, so it's a motel room. I thought it was her house for some reason.
No, because they go to her house, and she's like a bajillionaire, and it's a really pretty house.
Okay, so he explains about an oil operation in the Gulf of Mexico, drilling platforms, and $300,000 buys one share, but as soon as you buy it, the government-sponsored, some government-sponsored thing, they pay 2/3 of the drilling cost or whatever.
And then what, you can just out your money?
You triple the money in 2 weeks.
Whatever.
And he only has 140, and she offers to give him the 160. Falling right for it, he's acting coy at a lunch meeting with the husband, and the husband is hesitant, and Sawyer's like, just take the money home for the night. Sit on it.
Right.
And he starts...
But it was real money, right? Yeah. It wasn't fake money?
That was real money. He starts to rescind the offer and pays for lunch, and he starts to walk away, and then we get our wait moment with a little smirk. Yeah. He knew he would stop him.
Yeah. So, I mean, it was $300 for salad and drinks?
No, he was showing off.
Oh.
He was conning the guy still. He pops down $300, and he's like, Jesus, you just dropped $300 for water?
Right.
Or whatever he had.
Yeah, nothing.
Yeah, his nothing. Yeah, he thinks that costs $300. This guy's living in a different stratosphere than us.
Right.
I'm in.
Yeah.
Wait. Yeah. Don't leave. I don't want this to end.
Don't leave.
So, another thing I found out. This guy's name is Kilo. Don't know why it's
pretty
important.
Pretty sure he goes by Jay-Z.
Yeah. Jay-Z mixed with the prison guard that hated Sawyer. Or that was working with Sawyer or something.
Remember when he was
in jail? You'll see him coming up, I would imagine. So Sawyer meets up with Kilo, whose money he left with the Mark, as I call him.
Pool or whatever?
Yes. He tells him the deal closed today. And he's like, women are easy. You know, Cosmos, couple moves between the sheets they'd never seen before. And they think the scam is their idea.
Right.
And the husband needs to believe he could take the money and bail and become an honest-to-gosh outlaw.
Yeah.
And I think, Kilo kind of respected the grift at that point. He's like, man, you got this shit down pat.
Yeah.
It makes a lot of sense, but he's not going to do that. But just to have the option.
Right.
Yeah, I could see how that would be appealing to somebody who's going to fall for something like
so
that.
So this guy was just fronting the 140,000, right? For
for him to do the con to where they get double, and then, this guy keeps half of the
additional?
Yes.
So then Sawyer gets doing like all this 70 for 75,000?
Only for 75,000?
I mean, it seems like a lot to lay out. On the, like, you're laying your life out on the line for somebody to potentially kill you.
But he's a con artist. That's what he does.
I guess.
That's what he do.
I guess.
Well, or is it? He tells them they're in the oil business.
See, look how pretty that house is.
It is nice. It's big.
It's a lot of windows to clean.
Oh, man. A lot of fingerprints.
Yeah.
I just picture your kids climbing ladders and touching all the high up ones. Yes, they would,
too. And, like, put their faces on to, like, blow on it. Yeah.
Yeah. Week from tomorrow, the money's tripled, and he's about to leave, and then their son
and then what? They never say, like, oh, and then you have to leave your money in there for 7 years before you can withdraw it, or you...
No, he's saying you get it to...
You get it back? Somebody just writes you a check? Okay, well, follow up there, daddy-o. What the hell are you doing?
He said week from tomorrow their money's tripled, so meaning we'll pull it out
then. The husband should, like, ask a few more questions.
What? Like, I'm assuming they already did that, though, at the other meetings.
I don't think they did.
You don't think they confirmed things. Oh, yeah. Oh, by the way.
Oh, our money's going to
triple. How are we getting it back?
Right. Yeah. Is that going to just direct deposit into my bank account? Or
yeah, it'll just be tripled.
Is that going to come in form of, like, a 3-foot check?
It better be. It better be a check. Yeah, so he's about to leave until he sees their son. And then Sawyer loses his nerve staring at the kid. And the dad's like, what the fuck are you staring at him for?
Right.
And he's like, deal's off. And the wife starts losing her shit. And she's like, this isn't how it was supposed to work.
Right. They were supposed to get the money. She thought he was going to get the money and then they were going to split together?
No. She was just saying that you told me this was going to work this way.
Yeah.
But she said it in a way that implied to her husband that they had been talking about it.
Right.
Without him.
Well, yeah, because she introduced the scenario. She called the meeting, so...
Yeah, but...
I mean, it wasn't like a shock that...
I don't know. Then what the hell else could that have meant? This isn't how it was supposed to work. You really think she thought they were going to take the money and bail together?
I think so.
Okay. I mean, maybe she was just delusional thinking that would happen.
Yeah, I mean, did he say he loved her or she say she loved him?
He said he loved her.
Oh, yeah. So she thought that they were going to bail together and have this beautiful life and she was just going to abandon her husband and child.
So in theory, she could get her husband to front the money,
mm-hmm.
and then they would both take it, get their one share, do this actual thing because she believes it's real,
yeah,
triple their money, and then make off with that money.
Right.
That makes sense. Okay. So, but he looks at the kid, decides, fuck this, I'm out, leaves the money, and bails. So he left their money or
Kilo's
money?
Both, I think. That's what I'm like. You're not going to pick up the suitcase with your $140,000 in it?
Oh, so there are two suitcases.
Yeah. I think
Well, he's got... Yeah, there's two, because one's closed, and one's open there.
Yeah.
So he left the
both
money.
Of them.
Wow. That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, so then what? Kilo's coming after you for that $140,000, Sawyer? What are you doing?
He's probably coming after Sawyer for it at this point.
Well, hey, guess who won in this scenario? The married couple got extra $140,000.
They did, except... that guy has to know there was something going on with her and Sawyer.
Probably, but he probably didn't care.
Yeah, you just got 140 grand.
Yeah.
You doubled your money.
Right.
In 10 seconds.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that sort of worked out. That was the end of the episode. We go to Lost and...
It was good. I liked it.
Yeah. I'm assuming next episode is 1999 to something. Maybe it's just 1999.
Are we going to party like it's 1999?
We're going to podcast like it's 1999. There weren't podcasts then. Please leave a review on iTunes. If you like these shows, subscribe on YouTube. Subscribe on iTunes. Blah, blah, blah. Tell people to listen. Check it out. Interact.
If you like us, interact.
Yes. If you don't like us, definitely tell us stuff. Wait till the end of the show.
Tell Joel stuff. Don't tell me anything.
Oh, fine. Whatever. use our Amazon link at thisishowtowatchtv.com. Again, the recaps or walkthroughs, I think I'm going to call them recaps of the episodes.
Those are good.
They're one, two, and One and two are up
there. The Minute by Minute by Joel.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. MBM. Right. It doesn't sound good. See you later. This is how to watch TV. See you next year. Bad. I guess, bad jokes permeating
if
my life.
If you don't like the show, why are you still listening? That's what I'd like to know.
I already hit the end music. What are you still doing here?
Oh, well, I'm hungry. Are we going to eat some of it? All these memories in my mind. I'm still a secret lemonade drinker.